Okay. Hello. Good evening. Welcome. I think we should be up and running, ready to go now. The sound down here a little bit. Yep. Thanks for stopping in. So, first things first. Let us know here on Twitch chat if you're around, if you happen to be in the channel, if the pictures and audio are coming through okay for you, because they may not be. It's hard to say. So, that is because primary broadcaster Al Merriman is not here tonight. Unfortunately, I think he's getting facial reconstruction surgery so that he can bring you his own lovely mug there in broadcasting live color. And I'm sure that that'll really expand the viewership. But no, actually, I'm joking. He's simply not here. So it's me, and here I am. Looks like we have just gone to qualifying. And yeah, so the Season 29 Championship. This is the second round here at the Monaco circuit, the Monaco 88. Ooh, Ronnie Nunez disconnected early. That's typically not something he does until the end of qualifying, but Ronnie Nunez out a little early here, so hopefully he'll be able to get back in. And so yeah, the second round of the Season 29 Championship is underway here tonight at Monaco. And we're going to pick up the action here directly. The track itself needs no introduction, does it? I mean, after all, it's Monaco, and wow, here you go. Not only is it Monaco, but as you may or may not recall from last week, this Season 29 Championship is being fought with the Lotus 72Ds. So, quite the challenge. NAGP has really stepped up here, stepped the game up for these guys. Gone for full-on maximum challenge here for this Season 29 Championship. And I think a lot of questions were answered last week at Interlagos. We'll get into that race in a little bit coming up. The results, all the happenings, all the good stuff. But frankly, it was a great race. It did not disappoint in any way. The guys all did a great job keeping just the darn things on track, you know, first of all. And then secondly, being able, as we see Mike Greentrix there, bouncing off the wall there through Sandoval. And so there weren't, you know, an inordinate amount of retirements, these types of things. So I would say that the future is very bright for the Season 29 Championship. One thing's for sure, the drivers are absolutely prepared and ready to go and looking to get after it. So with that, we will get right to the action. And yeah, right on the board here with Matt Taylor, the second half of PMR. Matt Taylor, it was a good comeback from last week's race after getting bounced early in the first lap and having to recover. But did a nice job recovering in that race last week, coming all the way back up to sixth, if memory serves. But one of the very first to act here in this short 25-minute qualifying session, coming through the Nouvelle chicane there. So cuts will be monitored at that chicane and post-race. But if you were over, I believe it is seven cuts over at that chicane, you are going to get clipped one lap there in the official timing and scoring at the end of the race. So, whoa! Okay, well, that didn't work coming through the swimming pool complex there. And I tell you, that's something on these cars. It's the perspective can be a little tricky because those damn rear tires just stick out so far that if you cut it a little too close to the wall, yeah, it seems you're fine. You can get the front end through there okay. But the back end may not be so much. And I tell you what, that is exactly what caught out Matt Taylor. Now, Matt Taylor's teammate, Chris Moses here, looks like he is lining up. I think Chris Moses is on an out lap. Saw him flash by there, let the teammate Matt Taylor go for that last lap. So I suspect that Chris Moses is on an out lap here. But nonetheless, I'd like to stick on him here for a second. And let's just take a look at the driver's perspective, what they're dealing with. So this Monaco 88 layout here. With the setup, course, a very nice track, very nice layout. I would say a little bit more forgiving than some of the other layouts that are out there. And you know, you might think actually that the car with a pretty dramatic piece of iron and rubber to be negotiating around this place, actually not so bad if you are within the limits, within your limits. Outside those limits, and maybe not so much touch on that as well, but let's take a peek at what Chris Moses is going to go through here as he begins his first flying lap of this qualifying session. 20 minutes in now, coming up there to Sandoval, and boy, this one can really really sucking in with some late braking. Chris gets it pretty well there in second gear, keeps momentum good, but waits to get on that throttle until he's nice and straight. Coming up here through Maribo and of course into the Casino curve, gets a little wrong, a little wide there, I would say, on exit. Don't have to shoot to the right there, coming up for that, that cross street that comes in here on these cars so much. Not that big. Hairpin, of course, first gear for most of these cars. Let's see if he elects for first gear. Just first gear coming. Nope, going to take a shift up into second, coming through the tunnel now. And not too many problems. The braking is not too treacherous here coming into Newville chicane. These guys, I would say, he took some liberties there, but it looked like it was clean over the curbing. And through to back now, see if he does go all the way down into third gear, and actually holds the front end pretty nicely. Coming through the swimming pool complex, I assume this will be second gear for Chris Moses. Front end looks good. He's able to manage the rear end under acceleration quite nicely. This looks like a pretty good setup under Chris Moses, and the lap looks pretty good as well. Don't know if it'll be enough for a pole position type lap. 6 tenths off through that second sector, but coming to the line now, and it's going to slot him up there in third momentarily. So, okay. Chris Moses slotting third, and that's a look at what these drivers are going to be facing here tonight. And one thing to do it by yourself, pushing for speed there in this qualifying session. Another when you have 20 of your closest friends and allies, so to speak, in the heat of battle out there on track. So we have that to look forward to in a short 18 minutes from now after this qualifying session. I believe, switching to Aaron Parsons now. Aaron Parsons coming to the line. Don't know if this is a outlap. We'll give that a second, see that timing update, see if that time improves. Doesn't look like it has. But we can see Aaron Parsons' best time right now at 36.2. Not going to equal Ronnie Nunez's time on that provisional pole right now as we watch him coming up into the tunnel section of the course. So Ronnie Nunez showing some very nice time here, that 35.5 showing. And of course, teammate Luis Nieto also putting in some very fine practice times. I think that all things being equal, from what we've seen in the weeks of practice, those two are the drivers to beat here in terms of overall lap-to-lap speed. Race could be a different matter. Ronnie Nunez showing great speed, of course, last week at Interlagos, but came up short for that win. Did not get the win. We'll touch on that momentarily. But it is Ronnie Nunez now coming through the last couple corners. And, 3.9 seconds off. This has got to be an outlap. But let's give him a second to cross the line here and see if that timing does change for him. Still showing a 35.5 and has not changed. So we know that teammate Luis Nieto should surely soon be on a timed lap himself, as we are, almost 10 minutes clicked away here in this qualifying session. And Luis Nieto yet to put in a time. It looks like he is somewhere about even to the first sector, however. And that will be even with teammate Ronnie Nunez. Continuing to try to kick Omar Gomez. I don't know why that is for sure, but somebody flipping through the timing and scoring, obviously clicking on the foot button on accident, I assume. And through to back now flashes Nieto. Such control and precision required through, all of these corners, but none more so than that swimming pool complex there. However, perhaps not quite so much here in this qualifying period when you are just trying to get your absolute best possible lap. Luis Nieto showing 2 tenths off through that second sector. Teammate Ronnie Nunez coming out of the pits will navigate him, but Luis Nunez will slot into the second spot provisionally. So with 15 minutes to go, Luis Nieto slots into second behind teammate Ronnie Nunez. Chris Moses back out there on track, giving it another go here in fourth. So our second, whoa! Getting it just a bit wrong coming there through Mirabeau, or however you pronounce it. We'll find the outside wall, and that is not uncommon. That will happen not only by Chris Moses, but from a few other of our competitors here tonight, particularly if they try to go side by side there through the race. Now this is John Houston, who is going to spin it coming through turn one. And it does not look like he improved his time that lap. I don't know if that was an outlap or not. Let's take a quick look through the field here, as a matter of fact, as we begin our session. Kevin Savoy being shown in the fifth place provisionally, and that is a pretty good time. Now, Kevin has managed to turn a few laps here in the week of practice, so he may be pretty prepared for this race here tonight after what would be actually a very disappointing Interlagos race last week to start his season. Ran afoul of the equipment, putting a little bit too much pressure on that gearbox, and had to retire that car about two-thirds of the way through that race. So tough luck there for Kevin Savoy. John Lawton, however, did post a very fine result. If I'm not mistaken, that was a top 10, ninth, 10th, something like that for Lawton. He was certainly running inside the top 10. So John Lawton showing great pace here, provisionally in that sixth spot coming out of the pits now in quite a bit of traffic. So he'll have to try to find himself a free spot. John Houston, we checked in with John a little earlier. Looks like he is back into the pits and back out again, so we'll check back in with him, running currently provisionally eighth. Oscar Lithgow, part of SNL Racing. That team putting in a very fine effort last week. Sits third in that team classification. Looks like Oscar is currently on an outlap, but he's in any event, he's going to scrub that one off. He's going to race Mike Retrex. Provisionally in 10th. Showing, let's just take a look at what that lap time is. A 38 flat for Mike Retrex. So not too shabby there. With still some time to do some damage out there on track and move his way up the field. Kevin Miller in the 11th spot. So Kevin Miller showing some pretty nice speed here as well. So again, qualifying, of course, one thing, the race something else altogether. But speed is speed, and that's what all these drivers want, and Kevin Miller showing plenty of it. Marty Wren now letting some lap traffic go by there on his outlap as they try to get sorted out, but currently showing 12th on the timing pylon. Jack Ivey in 13th. And let's down board here with Jack as this could very well be a timed lap. Large green sector gaps are outlaps according to John Luden, and I suspected that was the case. Thank you very much there, John, and if anyone knows, it should be John Luden. Thank you so much for the broadcast app. It makes life so much easier, particularly here trying to do this singly. Cannot tell you how much it helps. Jack Ivey there in 13th. Just looked like he improved his time there. Didn't look for those big green sector laps, so might have been an outlap. I don't know, but Gregory Myers is coming out of the pits. I know he's sitting in the pits right now. Showing in 14th. Chris Chandler in 15th, coming up to the top. Chuck Carter as well, coming through the same corner. Currently showing in that 16th spot, but it has to be said, well and truly off the pace here, some 5 seconds back for Chuck Carter, and I'd say for anybody to be outside the 5 second mark, they probably have not gotten in their best lap yet. But it's a difficult proposition. Only we have run 14 minutes off of this qualifying session, but there are no guarantee of clean laps out there. 21 competitors out on track will put a few competitors in your way occasionally as you try to get the hot laps. We have seen that traffic here. John Lawton trying to navigate Sergio Calderon as we see him there in that 17th spot. He's in a bad spot there, I guess. Now he's back to pitch. Omar Gomez showing an 18th. Had a little bit of trouble joining the server before the race session here. Fortunately, he was able to get things sorted, got back in. So Omar Gomez will be able to take part to them tonight. Lou Mascarelli now P19 provisionally, and he seems a bit off the pace. No doubt Lou will want to improve from that position as Jonathan Cuppett perhaps a bit off the pace as well. They're in 20th, almost 10 seconds off the best lap, so you know that he's going to of course, showing on that timing pylon, and Joe LaCour actually serving a no-qualification penalty this week, so he will be starting from the back of the grid. And here we go, back to the front, as now qualifying session is on the other side of the side you don't want it to be if you haven't gotten your best lap in. Ticking away now, under 10 minutes to go, but Ronnie Nunez still looking good with that 135.5. And teammate Luis Nieto showing right behind him with that 35.6. Only two drivers in the 35s, and mid-35s at that. Aaron Parsons now trying to find an answer for that blistering time, and will he? I don't know, but I gotta tell you, I think that this team, Monty Python's racing team, Ronnie Nunez and Luis Nieto, have figured out a setup here which works very well around this Monaco circuit, and I think that's showing up directly in their speed. No doubt, very fine drivers, very fine speed regardless of anything else, and I think that they have a setup on top of that as well. That explains a little bit that time. So it is Chris Moses actually who has now clipped Darren Parsons barely for that third spot. Still not into the 35s. However, Chris Moses does improve his time and improved his starting position provisionally. Now with just those 8 minutes to go. So things tightening up just a little bit for those positions at the front. And I tell you, if you start anywhere on this race, you want to start more toward the front than you do the back. Question about it, and frankly, probably if you're not right at the front, you want to be right at the back. I suppose right in the middle is maybe one of the most dangerous spots to be, but nonetheless, you want that position to be as good as you possibly can. So now, Aaron Parsons looking to answer, flashing to the line now, and obviously had a big gap there, so I'm going to assume that was an out lap or a bad lap, one of the two. Chris Moses, however, is on a pretty good one. Oops, where'd he go? He's just now coming to the line. Oh no, back into the pits. Okay, we're going to see. Oh, and it's Luis Nieto now has jumped up front out of teammate Ronnie Nunez. So we know that that lap is better than a 135 now, and it is indeed now down to a 135.3, and will it go any lower? Will it go any lower? I don't know, but we're going to find out. So the battle within the team, you always want those team points. Always want to beat your teammate, you want the upper hand. You want to finish well as a team, you always pay lip service. Yeah, okay, we're team, we're going to do great as a team. Score points, win a championship. But always in the back of the head, there you go. And Ronnie Nunez trying to answer now, teammate Luis Nieto, up there in that second sector. But chances, takes some chances here in that third sector. If you really want to nail it, it's got some traffic in front. I believe that is Omar Gomez. I don't know. Somebody. Oh, looks like Ronnie Nunez has scrubbed that lap off, so he's not going to get it in. Chris Moses still not showing much on those sector times, so don't know what's going on with that. Aaron Parsons now should be through that first sector, so I'm going to see what that is. Nope, 3.9 off. Okay, well, how about this? How about we just say that I don't have any idea how to read the timing pylon, and we aren't going to bother too much with it. They show up green, well then we'll talk about it, and if not, then no problem. Okay, but we can watch them, and we will know that the time will change when they cross the line, so we'll know that for sure. So Ronnie Nunez not showing much there through those sector gaps as they show. And I tell you, looking through timing and scoring, John Houston looks like, Kevin Miller. Kevin Miller has jumped up now to eighth, as hopefully you can see on your screen if my resolution is not too bad for you. It looks like he has been there turn one, but nonetheless, Kevin Miller has picked up some nice ground, and that will put him much farther up the grid than where he was. He was right there at the back, so good news for him. Looks like Kevin Savoy is in the pits. We're going to check in here with Ronnie Nunez, showing 1.5 seconds off, but he's in the pits. Chris Moses, well, we know that Chris Moses is out on track. And instead of just flailing around and flashing all over the place, let's go ahead and stick on board with Chris Moses on this lap here. And see how it goes for him and see if we can get some type of idea of what kind of time. I tell you, actually, looking through the times, if we flash back to the... Yep, still 36 flat. I did notice Kevin Savoy, he has bettered his time now also, that 36 flat range, so throw a blanket over third through six right now, because that's about all that separates those three in terms of time and this position. And boy, speaking of time, it is running out now, just 4 minutes left to go in this session, and so it is all to play for, particularly those three. I mean, shoot, you pick up just 1/10 of a second, you pick up three spots if you're Kevin Savoy at this point, and Matt Taylor, of course, still up there in six, so we'd like to improve that position as well. As it is Chris Moses now coming through the final corner and flashing to the line, and we will see if he improves. And it is not going to happen that lap, but I want to stay on board just long enough, and we will make sure we don't miss any of the other action here, just long enough to see that first sector gap. See if I can get a sense of how to read this, or if indeed I just need updated broadcasting tools here. Ah, okay, now we're seeing something. Okay, so perhaps all were outlaps after all. So Chris Moses now showing that 0.1 seconds to the good on that provisional pull time. So, interesting times indeed, and Chris Moses knows that as well as anyone. Ah, old app version of the sectors are screwed. Well, there's the definitive action once again. However, nonetheless, I can't help but be intrigued by seeing that 0.1 to the good here by Chris Moses. Ooh, late braking there. That may actually not have cost Chris Moses, however. That is one of those happy accidents which could actually have helped him, sliding the rear in there just right. Can occasionally give you some benefit. Now that sector time does show 0.4 seconds off now. Whether or not that is accurate, I'm not 100% sure. But nonetheless, ooh, Aaron Parsons, as we have watched that action, has once again jumped Chris Moses. We'll stay on board here just as Chris Moses is just now finishing up to see if he does at least. Oh, and takes it too far to the outside and clips the corner on exit. So that's going to be... that's going to be the end of that lap, and Chris Moses may be able to get one lap in, but he is going to have to hurry, as he is just going to have about 10-second cushion here coming out of the pits to get another lap in. So we'll see if he's able to do that. Aaron Parsons now, as mentioned, has picked up his time, showing on the sector board as being up on the provisional pole time. Traffic coming out in front, and Aaron Parsons is going to slot into second, so another driver now into the 35s. That is indeed going to be a 35-5. Aaron Parsons jumping up into second and dividing that Monty Python's racing duo of Luis Nieto and Ronnie Nunez. And now if Ronnie Nunez is out there on a time lap, he is. Looks like he is off that last lap by 0.3 seconds. So one more lap for Ronnie Nunez to get the job done and steal a pole and one championship point. Let's not forget that the championship point comes away with that pole position as well. So Ronnie Nunez will be pushing very hard here, showing off in that first sector, according to the timing pylon, so we'll have to see if that improves, but it looks like Ronnie Nunez is on the outside looking in at the moment, as Aaron Parsons possibly bettering that time he just put in, and perhaps making a late bid to steal the pole here on his last lap. It is all coming down to it now, as this is where the action is taking place. No big jumps from further back down in the field. Aaron Parsons showing once again up in the second sector. Oh, and a big slide coming through the semi. Don't know how well that showed up in your picture, but let me tell you something. That was close. Holy cow, Luis Nieto showing up huge in the second sector. I don't know what's going on with that. It looks kind of improbable to be up 3 seconds, but Aaron Parsons now flashing to the line, and well, let's just see here. Oh, he did improve his time. But it's not enough. Luis Nieto. Oh, Ronnie Nunez makes a late charge. Oh, that was Ronnie Nunez. Wow. Well, Ronnie Nunez is going to slot back into second. Luis Nieto is done. Aaron Parsons is done. That is it for those guys. Wow. Chris Moses, he, I think, may have gotten this lap in. He may be our last man to have a say here in this qualifying period. And if he crossed the line before that timer ran out, let me tell you something. It was by the skin of his teeth. Whoa! Gets a little pushing them just way too hard, and that is, I think, going to do it. Was looking good through the first sector, but I think he is going to cost himself too much time with some wall dings, and yeah, he is going to go ahead and just give it up. So, wow, Ronnie Nunez able to respond, pick up the second place on the grid, not able to respond to the tune of that one extra bonus point and being able to overtake teammate Luis Nieto. No. It is Luis Nieto who's going to sit on the pole position for this second round of the Season 29 Championship. And wow, that came right down to it for those top four competitors. It's going to be Luis Nieto starting from pole position. Teammate Ronnie Nunez in second. Aaron Parsons slotting third. Chris Moses will take fourth. And Kevin Sabala made a very fine effort there in that qualifying period for fifth place on the grid. And those are very important starting spots if you want to try to stay out of trouble. Now, looking a little further back, I think it has to be said, Matt Taylor, our last season's championship winner, driver's champion, actually perhaps languishing just a little bit there in that sixth spot. Nonetheless, a pretty good effort. But last I looked, it was about 1.5 seconds off the leader's pace. And that is without winner's weight. So I kept the board up there so you could see some of the weight ballast has accrued for these drivers. You can see Luis Nieto, based on results from last week, showing up with that 20 kilograms of success ballast. Ronnie Nunez 10, Chris Moses 15, and John Houston there in 7th with 20. So it was actually Aaron Parsons, who does not show any weight, oddly, and who should have weight, and may. I saw actually popped up just now late for Luis Nieto and Ronnie Nunez, so perhaps Aaron Parsons actually does have his weight, but just not showing up for whatever reason. You see, it's kind of disappearing there. In any event, it was Aaron Parsons actually coming away with the win last week at Interlagos in what was actually a pretty thrilling race. It was Ronnie Nunez who got the drop on the green flag, but Aaron Parsons going for an alternate strategy, running the softs in that race and running a two-stop strategy in that just what turned out to be 55-minute race. But it happened to be the right call, as Ronnie Nunez left it a little late for his pit stop, his one and only pit stop, running out of fuel as he entered pit lane, and was very fortunate was Ronnie Nunez to be able to get into the pit lane, get that fuel, and get back out on track. But it definitely cost him the win and handed it to Aaron Parsons, all things being equal. And now we see Aaron Parsons' weight popping back up. So perhaps those are some late admin adjustments or something that are putting that weight on there. I don't know. But nonetheless, a very interesting race last week. And as a result, that is going to put Aaron Parsons out front of this team championship, 24 points for that win. Now it's all tied up there in second place, between Ronnie Nunez and Chris Moses. Ronnie Nunez took but third in that race, but as a result of leading the most laps and getting the pole position last week, he collected 2 bonus points. So all tied up there for second place with Chris Moses. Chris Moses, of course, starting from that fourth spot where Ronnie Nunez is starting second here tonight. So all to play for there. Matt Taylor currently running fourth in that championship, and Ian Jolicoeur fifth. So Ian Jolicoeur, a lot of work here to do tonight if he wants to salvage some good points as he is starting from the back. But nonetheless, a good solid championship start for all those drivers. And it is the T-Brock Dan Bam squad, Aaron Parsons and John Houston out front in that team classification, with PMR's Matt Taylor and Chris Moses there in second. So still very early days yet in that season 29 championship, and those will change. But I tell you, if these drivers do have designs on winning that championship, a lot of it could very well come down to tonight, because this is going to be a very difficult race. We haven't had the opportunity to talk a lot about the permutations of this race, and we'll just flash them. We're just looking to see if anyone's on anything but the soft. Sergio Calderon on the hards, and it looks like that's it. Everybody else on the softs. Very easy to get in trouble on this track here tonight, and very easy to damage these motors if these guys have significant contact with the Armco. So a difficult test for these guys who expect to win this championship tonight, and we're going to see what happens in just about 1 minute and 8 seconds. So yeah, we know our top five order, starting from the sixth position now. It is Matt Taylor. John Houston is going to start seventh. John Wathen put in a great qualifying effort for eighth. Kevin Miller as well will start inside the top 10 for ninth. Oscar Lithgow for SNL Racing will start 10th. That is a very fine start for him. Mike Grichuk is going to take 11th. Jonathan Cuppett will take 12th. Marty Uren, perhaps not his best lap, for 13th. Jack Ivey takes 14th. Curtis Chandler is going to start 15th. The NAGP veteran Gregory Myers will take 16th. Chuck Carter takes 17th. Sergio Calderon is at 18th. Omar Gomez, 19th. Lou Mascarelli starts 20th. And Ian Jolicoeur, as mentioned, will be starting from the rear. Oh, and it looks like Sam Rolfe was able to join the grid late here tonight, so it's great to see Sam on track. He's going to be starting from the very tail end. So let's make sure I click on my name here, and it should just spit me right back into the pits, and we are going to start this second round of the Season 29 Championship here at Monaco 88. And it is a good start from Lewis Nieto. It looks like Aaron Parsons may have a possible look at Ronnie Nunez. No, it's a slow start from Aaron Parsons. Chris Moses is going to slot in third. And so it is Chris Moses getting the jump on Aaron Parsons and taking over that position. Let's see what he's able to do with it as we watch the field come up for the first time. Ian Jolicoeur has somehow made a very fine start up to 16th. That looked like it could have been a very aggressive start, but nonetheless, you have to wait for the order to shake out a little bit before the timing pylon will give you some completely accurate information. I want to just keep it in the middle of the field here just for a second or two. Look for any incidents out there on track before we really get caught up on the action and what's going on up front. Boy, I have to tell you, what a great start. It looks like so far so good for the majority of this field. We might have seen something just a little something back there from the Nouveau Chicane. I thought I saw a little smoke back there, but looking good. Wow. What a professional, what a pro start by these guys. Unbelievable. Lewis Nieto is going to lead them into the last corner to begin to end the first lap here at Monaco for the second round of this championship. And look at that, already out to quite a big lead goes Monty Python's Racing duo. Okay, so it is Chris Moses did get that jump out on Aaron Parsons, picked up that position, but quickly slipping off the pace here a little bit. So we know that everybody, all these guys are on the sauce with the exception of, Sergio Calderon? Is that who you're looking at? I'm not sure, but anyway, sauce for all these guys now. Frankly, I can't tell you if they plan on running half a race distance, or I should say, on these tires, or if they plan on going short and taking the hards, or if they plan on running two stops, I simply don't know. I have no idea. So we're all going to find out at the same time, and it'll be a good story for all of us when it happens. Aaron Parsons not giving up any ground here at all. And I have to say, I don't know if Chris Moses is being a little careful here, or if he's just trying to feel the car out, or if he's just a little off the pace. But boy, you have to say, compared to the front two, he is a little off the pace. I think everybody else is kind of holding station back there, whilst that Monty Python's Racing Squad has jumped out to a pretty decent lead here. Very early in this race, of course, but everybody else running within 1 second of each other, with the exception of those two out front from the field. So, Aaron Parsons, I suspect here, if Chris Moses keeps his pace up, Aaron Parsons could possibly find a little bit of speed, maybe try to work his way up to Chris Moses and try to make that pass. But as we know, here at Monaco, not going to be such the easiest thing to do around this place. And boy, the slightest, tiniest mistake here, and it is race over. Ova with an A-H in honor of the our regular broadcaster. Not here tonight. Not on assignment either, but simply out for this race. And hopefully he will be back controlling the broadcast pictures next week, because he does, of course, an excellent job with that and has much better equipment, so to speak. Than myself, of course. Can just keep my eye here on this Moses battle, just to see if it stabilizes a little bit before we really try to take a look back here and get a sense of what's going on in the field. And I think it has stabilized just a little bit. So let's try to put our eyes and get a sense of what's going on through the rest of the field here. This is Kevin Savoie. Now, he started in that fifth position. He maintains fifth position, so too with Matt Taylor. Showing some very fine pace here early. I suspect that these guys are more or less kind of feeling things out with the car. And if they find that their pace is pretty good and things are feeling good, they may try to lean on the tires just a little bit more, see if they can't really come down to their ultimate pace. But it is Kevin Miller now who has picked up a couple spots. Kevin Miller starting from he started from the eighth position, so picking up one position is Kevin Miller, and John Houston as well up there, though I cannot... Oh, it looks like Chris Moses has just had some type of problem. I'm going to assume that is a problem, because he had a good second or so on Aaron Parsons. So Aaron Parsons did find a way by, either on the front straight or coming through one. Aaron Parsons to second. Chris Moses back to fourth now. And so it is Kevin Miller and John Houston involved in a very tasty fight here with Oscar Lithgow not too far behind. And you know what? Where is Oscar's... I don't think Oscar's teammate is here tonight. So, SNL Racing, let's see. Yeah, fourth in championships, the second half of SNL Racing. And I got to look here real quick to make sure I know who that is. Ronnie Suarez, that's who I was trying to think of. Yeah, not here tonight. So, that's an early blow to their team championship. But Oscar Lithgow looking pretty good in that ninth spot. And Mike Greitrex has come up to the 10th spot and running a bit on his own here, though again it's early. Marty Wren has come up to 11th, picking up just a couple spots. But teammate Ian Jolicoeur picking up huge time. And I have to say, this is not sure exactly how Ian Jolicoeur is able to make this happen from dead last, picking up 10 spots here through 5 laps. Great job in any event to come up the field that quickly, so particularly with relatively little damage. So Ian Jolicoeur on a move, and we will certainly keep our eyeballs on him over the course of this event and see just how much damage he can do to this field. We see some red showing up on that broadcast application. We know that means there's some close battles going on track. John Wathen is one of the losers here. We check on some of the winners, the guys that have gained some ground. John Wathen, however, not doing quite as well as that. Now running in the 15th spot and trying to get by Gregory Myers. That is one tough ask to get by Gregory Myers. He will make it tough and he will make it clean. So, John Wathen running with a foul of something out there and losing quite a few positions from that. Shoot, what was it? Eighth starting spot? Sergio Calderon is back there currently in the 16th spot. Keeping it clean at the moment. Looks like there's something going on for position up there. And Wathen has gotten past. So, coming there through this casino corner, perhaps he got a good run off. Didn't quite catch it. Sorry, guys. But nonetheless, it's John Wathen here for that 13th position. Marquez and Sergio Calderon. Looks like these guys are all involved in a very tight fight here as well. Jack Ivey, Omar Gomez, Sergio Calderon, 18th, 17th, 16th, and that is Peter Myers up there as well. So all fighting for position on lap 6. Lap 7, well, lap 5 for these guys. So tight action there. We're going to get back up to the front as we see a lead change up there at the front. Real quickly, Lou Mascarella, Jonathan Cuppet. Okay, here we go. It looks like we did have a disconnection, so it must be Ronnie Nunez now. It must be Ronnie Nunez. Let me look for him. I don't see him on the scoring pylon anywhere. I don't want to say something and then be proven wrong. But it looks like he's out. Ronnie Nunez making some type of mistake out there on track, we have to assume, and killing that car, unless it was a disconnect. We have seen him have the occasional disconnects, but usually self-induced in qualifying to reset everything, try to prevent him during the race. Ronnie Nunez out, and that is a big, big blow. So, and that's just what we were talking about there for those championship runners. This is an important race tonight, a loss of points here, and that is a race you could look back on way toward the end of this season and go, if it wasn't for that one Monaco race. But that is that's for future thoughts and discussions, because for now it is Luis Nieto out front leading the way, and Chris Moses, where has he gone? Chris Moses now running behind teammate Matt Taylor, so Chris Moses perhaps flipping a bit of Armco himself and running in the fifth spot after quickly jumping up to third to begin this race. And then his teammate Matt Taylor having a bit of trouble there coming off the final corner was Matt Taylor. And teammate Chris Moses not quite going to have a look as they head back into one, but Matt Taylor was definitely showing some pace over Kevin Sanbois. And these guys, it looks like they settled down, they found some pace. Car felt good, and they say, okay, it's time to go, and I think, honestly, Ian Jellicoe now, and I think once these guys started to try to find where that limit was, they stepped over it. So now that they've stepped over, they got to go back and readjust that limit again. Ian Jellicoe actually looks like he just brushed that wall there on exit at the back, So all these guys, this race is not settled, and I think if you're anybody right now, you want to be Luis Nieto, obviously leading the race, but more than that, perhaps, is to have the gap. Okay, so no pressure from behind. I don't have to worry about anything. All I got to do is mind my P's and Q's, try to keep it off the Armcos. If I'm 3, 4, 5 tenths off my best pace, that's okay, but let's just survive. And I think a lot of these guys are going to have to start doing that already, because guys that were running up toward the front suddenly find that they are not. And Ian Jellicoe, again, was one of them. Made that blistering start all the way up to 12th. Now finds himself, again, back in 16th. And who knows, that could be as a result of trying to make an overtake or something. Yes, indeed, Mr. Luton, shown 22nd, but not able to interact with him and show him multiple laps down. I suspect he has pulled the parachute. And I don't know exactly what happened there, but nonetheless, big news there as the rest of the competitors now continue. And still 21 on track, so honestly, that was our very first retirement here in this race, and let's try to get you some action while I'm postulating on this, that, whatnot, and so forth, because right now it is Mike Greatrex and Kevin Miller having quite the dice, and really those positions all the way up into the fourth place for these guys are actually relatively close. I mean, from where they're at now, you could throw a stone to the guy down to the lower part of the track and hit him from there, so that's pretty close, really, all things considered. Oh, Mike Greatrex, get in. That is not a part of the track you expect to get wrong. And you'll have to excuse me if I forget the name of the corner, but whichever one it is, Mike Greatrex did indeed get it wrong, and very rare place to get it wrong. And I'm wondering, I didn't see exactly what happened there, but I'm kind of wondering if maybe he jumped on that throttle a little too quickly and got the rear out of shape, got that tank slapper situation and pointed the rear toward that that Armco. But now it's damage, and I tell you, these guys really do have to worry about blowing the motor with even small Armco contacts. But hey, it's going to cost you time out on track, as we see Mike Greatrex actually going very slowly. So that may be indicative of some serious splitter damage for him. So damage from that aspect will cause you time, and then of course the time in the pits to repair the damages. We see Mike Greatrex jump in early now. Frankly, I don't know if the cars are going to be able to manage the distance. If they stop now, I don't know. I kind of don't think so. So that can be very costly indeed for Mike Greatrex. But the battle right now is on for that 10th spot, and quite the top 10 battle brewing between these three. John Wathen, I lost track of where I was at. Well, the numbers keep flashing here, with different colors. I know that it was the 11th, 10th, and 9th spot. So, Wathen involved, Curtis Chandler there, Marty Urin also there. Is Marty, I believe that's Marty going wide. Wathen, excuse me, that's Wathen. I'll get it sorted. I'll get it, it'll happen. And if nothing else, you can see the scoring pylon as well as anybody, so you know who's there. But very intense action nonetheless, going for that 10th spot as Curtis Chandler continues to try to reel in John Wathen here. Oh, Curtis Chandler taking very deep to that Neuville chicane, trying to get away with some extra braking. And once again, 7 cuts over there in the results. And you are going to get popped. That's going to cost you 1 lap with a race. Wathen! Flipping the inside through the corner there on one of the swimming pool complex corners. And, he's in a bad spot. So he's going to... So he's going to try to figure out a way to get that spun around and get it out of trouble. But, Kevin Savoie now slipping. I tell you what. These guys... You know what else? I bet these guys could also be struggling a little bit on the softs, too. You know, once you overheat these tires, and if you do, if you have a spin, boy, you just have to be as careful as, I mean, like kitty litters on the track to cool these tires down if you expect to get any grip back at all. And I think we're seeing a little bit of that as well. So a little bit of tire degradation, a little bit of heat, as well as simply just pushing a little past the limit. Look, these cars are extremely difficult to control in the very best of circumstances. You add some heat, you add some tire degradation on top of that, and you could be in a little trouble. So, but having said that, you know, we haven't seen anybody jumping into the pits and getting off those tires. If we are going to see 2-stop strategies from these guys, we're going to see them come in here in just another lap or two. So we're going to find out right away, and when it happens, I tell you, about the whole field is going to be coming in all together. Ooh, as Curtis Chandler now makes a mistake. And, Kevin Savoie will make a mistake. And Kevin Savoie is just going to go ahead and give it up at this point. He says enough is enough. And boy, I got to tell you, I think that's a little early to pull the chute if you're Kevin Savoie, because, frankly, everybody's having a terribly difficult time trying to maintain a decent pace, and if you're anywhere on track, I suspect you have a chance to gain position, but you are one of the few that are not running into things that you aren't supposed to be running into. So, this battle over 10th, still pretty heated. Now, we know that Mike Greatrex has come in, so we got to think that Mike Greatrex has at least a fresh set of tires. Ooh, it makes a nice pass there! Coming through the last couple of corners on Mike Greatrex. A very nice pass and a pretty pretty big lower attachments type pass as well there on Mike Greatrex. But nonetheless, and it's Ian Jolicoeur there in that 11th spot. So all these guys fighting over that 10th spot here pretty vehemently, let's say. And anybody's game at this point. I think, you know, we haven't seen the retirements, but I'm kind of wondering if we're going to, right? So maybe just keeping on track. If you just manage to finish the race, maybe you can't find yourself within the top 10 spot by the end of the race. And it doesn't matter how you get there. Position is a position. If you get there because everyone else pulled the chute, well, there you go. That's still your position that you earned. But nonetheless, a few battles now going on a bit further up the field here. Looks now Chris Moses is coming out of the pit, so that was a pit stop for Chris Moses, and that looks to me like it could very well be a two-stop strategy, unless, of course, Chris Moses had accrued quite a bit of damage. He might have. We saw him slip back into positions, which could very well have been as a result of damage, but coming in from about the fifth position, coming out in seventh now, is not so bad, really, particularly if you are going to try that two-stop strategy. And for safety's sake, maybe it's not a bad idea anyway, just to slap on the fresh rubber. Take a quick breath while you're in the pits, maybe, if nothing else. And we're going to check on that progress. But we want to get quickly back here as we have not had the opportunity to talk too much about Luis Nieto. Now lapping all the way up into 12th place is Luis Nieto. So, whoa, Watson spinning through turn one. Lewis is happy that that happened after he made the pass, however. Lewis, dirt tracking it around Maribo. Now that is perhaps not the fastest way around when you have pavement, nothing but rubber, but nevertheless, pulls it off and continues on. So, no harm, no foul. We know that Luis Nieto has certainly run into some lap traffic by this point. 20 minutes in, but has handled it just fine so far. And continues to pull out ground on second place. Aaron Parsons. And he now will, that is Aaron Parsons, look for a way safely past the lap traffic of John Watson, who himself is actually turning in a pretty fine race, of course, was running inside the top 10, now running back in 13th. But that gap is 10 seconds for Aaron Parsons, and if you're Aaron Parsons, you know, can you at this point find a way to gain that time back? If you're thinking about strategy options, well, Luis Nieto isn't giving you too many of that because he hasn't come into the pits. You don't know what he's doing. If Luis Nieto had come in, then Aaron Parsons could be thinking, well, maybe I can make it one stop and try to gain some ground that way. But no, for now, it's just Luis Nieto continuing to gain ground to the tune of about, frankly, almost a half second a lap. So, frankly, it's a pretty tough ask for Aaron Parsons. Or is Aaron Parsons thinking at this point, okay, maybe second place is pretty good, and who knows, maybe Lewis will run afoul of some lap traffic and I can pick up that the position that way. So, it is Matt Taylor now running third, and he is well and truly off the back bumper of Aaron Parsons now, 16 seconds off. This is only 14 laps in now. These guys have been having some trouble out on track. Not so much Luis Nieto and Aaron Parsons, but third on back, those positions have been swapping. So he has either been having to avoid some people in front having problems or having to fight through them on his own merit, but in any event, it's going to have cost him a little bit of time. And I keep looking over on that pylon, see if any blue pops up for people stopping into the pits. And I haven't seen any. Don't know if it will. It usually does. But in any event, I keep looking over there to see if we see some pit stops popping up, which will change our order just quite a bit. But Matt Taylor now 16 seconds off of Aaron Parsons and nearly a full 30 seconds off Luis Nieto, so quite a bit off the pace. But it is John Houston, and these are the guys, I would say now, who have really managed the race. Not raced the best, but have managed the race the best. Okay. John Houston, now all the way up in the fourth. Oscar Lithgow running fifth. Kevin Miller, all the way up to sixth. These guys have done a great job of keeping the darn thing kind of safe, straight, and in control, and have gained just massive positions for it now. Still a little over 30 minutes to go in this event, and quite a few more laps to navigate a lot of these dangerous corners, but nonetheless, those guys are showing some great pace. Now, we know Chris Moses has come into the pit, so Enzo Laporte is back up to eighth. Boy, he has really yo-yoed. I mean, how the hell did he get back up to eighth? So, I'm thinking now maybe that these guys have started to make some stops. Let's see, we see Kevin Miller. Okay, looks like Miller is into the pits, and that is on lap 15, but it's really only 24 minutes short, or rather 6 minutes short of halfway. So I don't know if we can really call that a two-stop or not, particularly if you were to slap on a set of cars. I'm not going to look, because if I do it, it'll screw up the timing and scoring that I do have here for a minute or two, and really I'd rather just I'll get more confused as I already am. But, it is NAGP chiming in. What happened to everyone? Well, what happened to everyone was the track itself. Basically, Monaco has happened to these drivers. And it's like Kevin Savoy has pulled the chute early. Big story, really, is Ronnie Nunez. So, and we do get confirmation now. It was actually an accident for Ronnie Nunez. So, contact with the Armco for Ronnie Nunez. And that is unfortunate. Tough break, buddy. Sorry that happened to you. It was Ronnie Nunez and Luis Nieto both taking big chunks out of the field, running one and two. But Ronnie Nunez running a foul, and his now teammate Luis Nieto, who has come into the pits, followed shortly by Aaron Parsons. Both in and out of the pits now and back on track, but Aaron Parsons has picked up a whole bunch of time here. So some four or 5 seconds has Aaron Parsons picked up on that pit stop rotation, and once again, this race nearly half over. So we have to assume at this point that those drivers are going to go ahead and make this just a one-stop race. And I can't help myself. I just have to flip over here and see if we can see what kind of tires these guys have elected to go for. So. It is a sauce once again, and we have to assume that those guys are going to be on those tires for the rest of the event. Ian Jolicoeur did switch over to the hards at some point, so Ian Jolicoeur has come in for his stop as well. And we have to assume that Ian Jolicoeur is going to go the rest of the way, but Ian Jolicoeur now up to 8th. And Ian Jolicoeur starting at the very back, then up to 13th, got put back to 17th, and now back up to 8th, so it's been a wild ride here in Monaco for Ian Jolicoeur, but showing up very nice in the timing and scoring at the moment. Chris Moses is going to cycle back after stops to that fourth place position with teammate Matt Taylor running third. So those positions have not changed. John Houston, that was certainly a cut there at the Nouvelle Chicane, and hopefully he does not go over that seven mark that we talked about. The positions, John Houston, 5th, 6th, Oscar Lithgow, 7th, Kevin Miller. You see on track now, those positions not changed since pit stops. However, if we look a little further back, we can see John Wathen has picked up a couple spots. And we have to assume that he has made his pit stop. Frankly, assuming everybody's made their stop. could be incorrect, but nonetheless has done a good job recovering a few positions. So we're going to look just a little further back now, as we see a pretty good fight going on now for the last points, and Luis Nieto running up on this battle as well over those final points paying positions, and there is a bit of separation. Ooh, it's Jonathan Cupid. Looks like, okay, Jonathan Cupid has now come in for his pit stop. I see, okay. So Lou Mascarelli, they're running in 19th, just a little up the road. It is Sergio Calderon and Chuck Carter now running just one position out of the points. here at Monaco as they begin their second stint. And hopefully for these drivers, it was a good opportunity to get in, get some tires on, take a quick breath, and kind of try to reassess the situation a little bit and come up with a game plan, frankly, for what it is they need to do. For their second stop, we see a battle going on just a little further up the road between Ian Jolicoeur and John Wathen. I think that was actually John Wathen coming through Ian Jolicoeur there for that ninth position. And I tell you, this is really down to tires, as those hards do suffer a pretty big performance hit over the softs. And I suspect John Wathen just does have a little bit of pace, but Ian Jolicoeur was a very early stop for Ian. And I think that he went ahead and topped up the tank and slapped on the hards, planning on running that early stop and then going the rest of the way. But he is hanging close as a result of John Wathen hanging the rear end out all over the place. And I believe he is even going to go for this pass and make it. Stick coming through the tunnel. And now all they have to do is survive the Nouvelle chicane. But it looks like they have done that just fine. So it is Ian Jolicoeur back now through to the ninth position. Or, you know, actually, Ian Jolicoeur in front, actually, he could have just made a pit stop and waiting for his tires to come back up to temperature. But in any event, something like that happened. Now we see it is it's Marty Wren fighting with Jack Ivey. And I believe Marty has just made that pass on Jack Ivey. We see the lap traffic of Matt Taylor trying to get through those positions. But pretty good race here for Jack Ivey coming out after your stops running 12th. That is not too shabby. And I believe that was just about where Jack Ivey started this event. He had a good qualifying effort. So still hanging up there, still doing well. And still, I have to say, I'm very impressed. We've seen these positions change. We've seen these drivers have trouble. Well, we've only had two retirements. And I'm frankly amazed. I mean, well done. Absolutely amazing job by these guys to come up with only a couple of retirements. One, for sure, from an accident. And probably most notably, of course, and you may or not remember, Ronnie Nunez from that second position. Having contact with the Armco and out of this event, and so too Kevin Savoy. He pulled it off at the Nouvelle chicane, so, and pulled the chute from there. So, no position change toward the front. Positions 1 through 7 have remained constant. Ian Jolicoeur just picked up that 8th position over John Wathen. That fight is still more or less on, as John Wathen, you see, running just a corner or two behind. And if you're at Monaco, that's still plenty close for the slightest of mistakes to get you to earn you that position back again. And right now, it looks like one of the better battles on track is a little further back here between Mike Greitrex and Sergio Calderon. Mike Greitrex actually will get through Sergio Calderon pretty easily. I suspect Sergio has a bit of damage and is really trying just to survive the last half of this race, which now actually is, actually it looks like Sergio Calderon has pulled it into the pits. So Sergio Calderon going for a pit stop. Beyond that, one of the closer battles, relatively close here anyway, John Houston and Chris Moses running within 5 seconds or so of each other, as Chris Moses had to negotiate some lap traffic and brought that battle pretty close up. And we see Curtis Chandler jumping out of the pit. So a few more pit stops going on, and I think part of my confusion here now I see has stemmed from, I think there are a few guys out there running two stops strategies. I think some of these guys now are completing their second stop on those two-stop strategy. Could be that they're coming in with damage and just wanting to get the damage fixed, because, you know, why not? But in any event, the field has well and truly sorted out. But if we look at the gap toward the front, I'm going to say that for whatever reason, actually there's a battle going on there for 12th. Gregory Myers and Curtis Chandler now, with Jack Ivey not too far up the road either. That's a battle for 11th. That 11th position, one position away from the top 10, and that's a coveted spot here at NAGP, so that's an important position for those guys. But, ooh, I was watching that gap there toward the front, and it is Aaron Parsons not giving up anything right now to Luis Nieto. That gap, in fact, has come down just a little bit. I think that was as a result of Luis Nieto having to get through through John Wathen's car. That's ninth place now. Luis Nieto has lap two. So we call John Wathen lap traffic. Really is running a very good pace, just not quite up to the same pace of Luis Nieto, and Aaron Parsons closing behind. That gap, as mentioned, was right at 6 seconds that whole way after those pit stops. That was actually quite a few laps ago, and now down just to five. So Aaron Parsons not giving anything up. And I wonder if that is as a result of Aaron Parsons gaining some pace, or Luis Nieto perhaps just playing it really cautiously. And who could blame anybody for doing that at this point, right? Two guys maybe not as willing to play it as cautious right now is Gregory Myers and Curtis Chandler. Going for that 11th spot at the moment. Coming through the hairpin. And I don't know why I forget the name of that damn car. The hairpin. But it's something. The corner after that is what? Portier, or however you pronounce it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, this fight, well and truly on. Gregory Myers, one of those drivers that is going to get stronger as the race unfolds. Curtis Chandler, too, to an extent. But Gregory Myers makes a living around this place, running stronger than the competition closest to him late in races, and I think we're seeing that very same thing happen here. However, Curtis Chandler, notorious tough pass, and will not make life easy for Gregory Myers. If you're Greg Myers here, I think one thing you have going in your favor is a whole bunch of patience, a very patient driver, he's not going to over-force the issue, let's put it that way. He will wait for a good opportunity, maybe try to generate one to some extent, but he will not overshoot in trying to force that mistake from the competitor in front. So the battle very much on for that position. And if those guys do run afoul of anything, I tell you, there's a few guys behind them who wouldn't mind if they did smack an Armco or two, because there's a few guys in arrears, out of the points at the moment. Mike Greatrex, Sergio Calderon, Lou Mascarelli, 17th, 18th, and 19th right now, who would like to slip into those points-paying positions. But on the outside, looking in as we speak, and boy, looking at the timing pylon, looks like Jack Ivey not running too far off of Marty Uren, as we see those colors pop up for Marty Uren now occasionally. And I don't think that has anything to do but the pace of Jack Ivey. Marty Uren, not appear to me, has been able to pull away from Marty Marty has not pulled away from Jack, rather, to any extent. So, a little intriguing, Marty Uren, frankly, it has to be said, running a bit off the pace, or perhaps he has picked up some damage, I don't know, but It is all right there for them as it was Marty Uren now jumping into the pits, and perhaps he did pick up a bunch of damage. It's either a two-stop strategy here for Marty Uren, or he had picked up a bunch of damage that he needed to fix, and that will change the order once again. Now Jack Ivey's going to slot into the top 10 as a result. And what a great drive for him if he can hold that position. John Wathen up into 9th, and Ian Jolicoeur in 8th. So, Ian Jolicoeur, should he manage to finish this position or better, will be a remarkable drive coming from the back. Ooh, as we see the rear wing on that car is seriously deranged, so Ian Jolicoeur is electing to stay out there with a less than healthy Lotus 72D, it has to be said at this point. And he seems able to manage the car okay, I guess. I'm not in the cockpit, so who knows, but nonetheless, hopefully that won't fly off and hit somebody as they're coming behind him. But a little funny to see Ian Jolicoeur there running eighth positions toward the front have not changed. So quickly, let's go through them as we still have a bit of race to complete here. Another solid 10 minutes or so of racing in this event. Lewis Nieto continues to lead Aaron Parsons, who is now 14 seconds off the back gearbox of Lewis Nieto, and we have to assume that Aaron Parsons has run into something out there. Aaron Parsons' wing does not look too bad. Front looks okay, so don't know what happened there, but now off the back bumper of Lewis Nieto, Matt Taylor still running third. Chris Moses, some 8 seconds off of teammate Matt Taylor, so Chris Moses in fourth. And John Houston, well and truly back off our lead pace now, nearly by a full minute in fifth. But you know what? That's the way it goes. I mean, you have the pace that you have, and particularly here in Monaco. If you're in Monaco, you know, job number one is, regardless of pace, is finishing the darn race. So you get what you get. So the battle back here is still the battle between this what is now for 10th place. Gregory Myers, Curtis Chandler, not too far off of Jack Ivey up in front of there, as we see Jack Ivey just now flashing through. Oh, and it's a mistake now by Curtis Chandler. That's going to allow Greg Myers to make a run as they approach to back. Let's see how far. Yeah, Marty Uren. So Marty Uren came out of the pits quite a ways back from that group. Not within shouting distance, that's for sure. We have to take some water here, folks. And so it is the battle that you are looking at, which is still the closest battle on track as we speak. Keep looking over at that timing and scoring pile to see what positions may suddenly change. It can happen, and in fact, it will happen here at some point. Now, if my theory holds correct, and there are a few drivers still out there hoping to run a two-stop strategy, we'll still see a few of those drivers filter into the pits here to complete those stops. So that's something we'll also have to keep an eye on. But nonetheless, ooh, it looks like, actually, now that I mention it, it is Chuck Carter now at some point. Looks like some... 7 laps ago or so, actually. Looks like he has run afoul of some track parameters also, so Chuck Carter. So 3 retirements now, but still, if I was a betting man, I would certainly have the over on that bet here for retirements to this point at this race. So, pretty good, and these guys still battling just as hard as they possibly can. I think... should be said for my... Oh, Aaron Parsons now has slipped back into the fourth spot, and boy, was that a pit stop. So Aaron Parsons had... I'm assuming it was a pit stop, but yeah, it's a 30-second gap. He had 16, and in fact, that could have... But that wouldn't have explained the gap difference, 16 seconds before he came to the pit. Well, in any event, the car looks okay. I'm going to assume that that is a second pit stop for Aaron Parsons. But, nonetheless, that is a position change. So now, if the likes of Matt Taylor and Chris Moses, if they, well, those guys did stop. It was only 35 minutes left to go in this race when they stopped for Aaron Parsons and Luis Nieto. Moses and Taylor stopped a little bit before that. So, not sure exactly what happened here for sure. But, in any event, is Chris Moses now, or Aaron Parsons rather, now in the fourth position? And PMR's Matt Taylor and Chris Moses, second and third. What fortune, what has fortune brought for that team? And Aaron Parsons back in again. Aaron Parsons back in again. Wow. So, now I'm pretty stymied. Now I'm wondering if, Well, if it was damage, why hadn't he stopped the previous lap? I mean, if he had really smacked the wall or something. Unless he was beyond the pit lane or something. Maybe that's what it was. I don't know, but now with two stops, Aaron Parsons, that's out of it. And I mean, unless something... Well, I better not call it too early, but that he's probably... Probably out of it for that second position now at this point. I don't think there's any way. And big blow to our championship leader, Aaron Parsons, right there now. Luis Nieto always looks like he's going to be a threat for that season 29 championship himself, but did not come away with as many points as he would have liked there at Interlagos. And for our championship leader, Aaron Parsons, should Luis Nieto finish here? We may not be able to completely overcome that gap to Aaron Parsons for the lead in this championship. It would fall to, at this point, Chris Moses, I believe, or teammate Matt Taylor. But a shakeup is in the works at the very least. Let's just put it that way. So, Aaron Parsons dropping back to fifth will also put teammate John Houston into fourth now. They are running very close on track, Aaron Parsons and John Houston, just a couple seconds apart. And so we'll see if team orders come into effect and John Houston does give up that position to Aaron Parsons as having the higher team driver championship points or not. They'll have about another 15 minutes to decide that strategy one way or the other. Or perhaps I'll just do it right now. Why are those two cars not the same color? Do I not have my skins correct or something? Because, well, anyway, John Houston's going to go ahead and let it through. And that question has been answered very easily. We'll see. So it's 40 seconds now from Aaron Parsons to third place Chris Moses. Can Aaron Parsons gain that position back if Chris Moses stops? The answer is, I don't know, but I suspect it would be very close. And also at this point, if Chris Moses can go the rest of the distance, you have to think there's no way he's going to come in, even if the tires go off. Aaron Parsons for sure can't gain that time on track. I wouldn't think. Well, maybe. I guess it depends on what the performance advantage is if Aaron Parsons did take tires or just... I frankly don't know what happened to Aaron Parsons, so was it damage? Was it just a third stop? I guess we're just going to wait and see. Frankly, at this point I am trying to fill time since there is hardly any direct fights going on out there on track of note. So let's just keep that in mind as we search for these possibilities that I am trying to say absolutely anything I possibly can at this point to fill time. But Omar Gomez and Marty Wren, rather, will take the heat off me a little bit in that regard, as that has now become a fight. Chris Moses has come up. Well, he's either coming to the pits, and damn, why didn't I keep my eye on that? As he is either coming to the pits or had a problem, and boy, I got to think that was as a result of coming to the pits. And so there you go. The question has been answered. If Chris Moses comes into the pit, will Aaron Parsons be able to challenge for that position? The answer is yes. Because there we go. There it is. So one way or the other, We have that fight now is on for third place, and that answers the question also for Matt Taylor. And boy, that was a costly problem for Aaron Parsons. But it cost him those 10 seconds slipping off of Luis Nieto. Has also cost him a really reasonable shot here to get back into the second spot. Because now, with just really starting to run out of laps here with just about 10 minutes to go, Chris Moses will make it extremely difficult to get past. And frankly, if I were a betting man, which I am, I would put my money on Chris Moses not making a mistake big enough for Aaron Parsons to get past. But we shall see. I suspect, well, it seems very likely that Aaron Parsons does have the speed, so we will give that to him for sure in that equation. So difficult to get the braking wrong here. Aaron Parsons hits it just about correct, taking that semi-wide, the medium entry. Coming back down to the apex late in the corner. Braking a little early there, coming just rolling through in second gear, been hard, as hard as you can on the brakes in this car. And first, Parsons will is one of those that wants to stay in first. As opposed to short shifting 2 seconds. Running up to the chicane, Chris Moses rocketing out to a bit of a lead, but having that lockup in front. And we'll see if any of these drivers also run over on cuts there at the Nigo chicane, either on accident or on purpose. And something they will have to be careful of. Aaron Parsons perhaps a little wide on entry through that complex. Now through second gear, coming up the gears in the last complex. Jonathan Cupman in front of Chris Moses and Omar Gomez. That is a fight for position, actually, in front of them. Now for 14th, as they run up on that battle for 14th. This is Aaron Parsons now staring a podium right in the gearbox, as it were. Should he be able to find a way past Chris Moses? We suspect Aaron Parsons probably does have a bit of pace on Chris Moses. If those those first stint times hold down to the second stint, Aaron Parsons running a little more inside all the way through Maribota. Jonathan Cupman making a smart play. Omar Gomez will be getting out of these drivers' way as well as soon as he possibly can. So, in a bad spot if you're Omar Gomez, really, because that did allow Jonathan Cupman to pull right up to the gearbox. I have to say, overall, a very fine job, Omar Gomez. Getting those drivers by, but it is now Jonathan Cupman who's going to have a look at the Newville chicane. Not going to be able to get it done, but he's going to have a much better run coming out of the chicane. Not going to be able to take advantage. Shades of, who was it, Hamilton, and the Red Bull guy there. Won't make any comment on that, though I have some very strong thoughts. Ricciardo, right? Ricciardo, however you say it. Not quite exactly the same, as you can see, but nonetheless, still quite the fight for 14th. We want to make sure we don't miss anything here, but it's Aaron Parsons now. He's going to have to do some more work. Chris Moses running back into some lap traffic up the field as teammate Matt Taylor has come in. So, this is all to play for now, for these three up front now. And that is a direct fight for second place, all battling within 3 seconds. Heavy, heavy traffic in front. Looks like Matt Taylor has cleared up. Chris Moses now trying to get through as well. And that should allow Aaron Parsons. Whoa! On the outside goes Aaron Parsons around Lou Mascarelli. And that might have been a very bold move, but it worked out nicely for him. I think if you're Aaron Parsons, that was the right move to make. But It was also a very touch-and-go move. That is a move where you say, okay, well, this will probably work out. If it doesn't, then my race is over right here and now. But it's 7 minutes left to go, so it's all or nothing at this point. And these, oh God, that was so close. Aaron really having to take some precautions there, getting around the car of Mike Greatrex. And I think that it was a very good idea that he did. Aaron Parsons is not going to be happy with the time loss, but going to be much happier than what he would have been. And we saw the battle, John Houston, Kevin Miller, relatively close there, so I'm going to flash that one. But Aaron Parsons, that was actually quite close, I suspect, with Mike Richter. So it's good that he gave him a collection right there. And Chris Burns now, but I don't see teammate Matt Taylor in front of him. Oh, that's because Matt Taylor is way the hell up the road, so Chris Moses not making it through that lap traffic as well as Matt Taylor, I guess, or having some type of mistake, which allowed teammate Matt Taylor to escape a little bit, and it's Aaron Parsons. Now, still that couple seconds off, but it's not so much a battle between those teammates now for second, and more now a battle still for that podium, Chris Moses and Aaron Parsons. Wow, so a flurry of activity there with that lap traffic late in this race. To decide who is going to come home with these points, and let's not forget, it is Luis Nieto up there in front, leading the way still, and I haven't talked about him, and you know what, sometimes that's perfect. That's exactly what you want. You don't want anybody talking about you, seeing you doing nothing, because you're just out there running your own pace and controlling things. Has been doing. Certainly keep an eye on him. In the next lap or two, we will make sure we see him, because I suspect he is going to be pulling the checkered flag here in just the next couple laps. So, but as, I suppose we can get back on now to the TV view as Aaron Parsons perhaps not quite resigned to his fate, but not making perhaps the strong push that he was. 3 seconds now off the gearbox of Chris Moses. And the direct fight on track at the moment is the one for the final points. Mike Greatrex and Sam Rolfe now going at it. And let's see, Chris Chandler all the way up to 10th. Yeah, I just okay. Well, anyway. And whoa! So Sam Rolfe taking it very wide, having to make a correction there for the rear end, allowing Mike Greatrex a little bit of ground gained. The all-important points, and now those guys running into heavy traffic. As we see a late position here going. Colors changing up there for 9th, Curtis Chandler, John Wathen still going at it for that, but whoa! Curtis Chandler bouncing off it, oh! Still bouncing off walls. So that's John Wathen through for the 9th position with just a couple laps left to play. I assume, despite the lap counter reading 45 laps, that this race will end here at the 60-minute mark, but it might not. It might go 45 laps. Let's see, is Al too doped up to chime in on that? Is this thing going to go 45 laps? Hold on a second. Let's just let's see if we can race remaining 11 laps. You know what? This thing's going to go long. That's not by design, is it? Here I was, all getting ready to get wrapped up, and oops, what am I doing here? But I don't know. We may have more laps to run after all. Just in case, here in another minute, we'll check in with Luis Nieto. Give me 1 second here, guys. Okay. So, yeah, flurry of activity a couple laps ago, and the battles are still battles to be had out there on track, no doubt about that. We're seeing that, and as far as my knowledge goes, this is not like some oddly extended race. I don't think we have a few races here or there which go a little extra long. And it could just simply be that the laps are off a little bit for this race, and if that's the case, then we've got 9 more laps to run. I mean, that's just the long and short of it. So we aren't going to we aren't going to suddenly end if the checkered flag does not drop. But let's keep our eye on Lewis Nieto here, just in case this race does come to a conclusion here. The next time he crosses the line, next time after the next time he crosses the line. And to this point, oh, Sam Rolfe pulling the parachute from that 18th spot. So Sam Rolfe had actually gained some nice ground there in that first stint. Was running up in the solid points paying positions, but has come undone for him here late in this race. And Sam Rolfe out here for this stint. Right here with Lewis Nieto on this lap. We'll see if it is his last lap. I don't see a white flag out. I think we are going to have to run 45 laps in total here at this race. But just in case, we're going to stick on him. And what a race it's been if you're Lewis Nieto. And really, in the real world racing, the Formula One guys, you want to win Monaco. Well, you know what you do here too. And everybody thinks that, you know, this is their track. They drive this track the best, But hey, man, you start the race and it's put up or shut up. Now, if I was out there, then we'd really see something. But It's been a remarkable race, and even if you have the pace, even if you're careful, it's the type of track that can still catch you out. Lap traffic, pushing just a little extra hard, even if you're careful, it can still catch you out. You can still make a mistake. Everybody makes mistakes on this track and ends their race. It just happens. So this is a very remarkable run Lewis Nieto is having, and should he have to run another six laps here or so, which is going to kind of catch everybody out. Should he be able to finish this thing off, it's going to be a well-deserved victory. So we will reset on this end now. Not too many direct fights going on out there on track, but we're pretty firm now that it's going to run another 7 laps here until we see the checkered flag. So the one thing these guys... I don't know if they were aware of this. Frankly, if I was out there on track, it might be something I wouldn't be aware of. I might just totally disregard the lap counter, but whoa, as John Watherings runs the track. But yeah, these guys are going to have to make some extra stops. So, as we see the position change there, you know, had this race ended, well, John Wathen, he's in that ninth position. There you go. But he had to make an extra stop, and Greg Myers now runs ninth. Is Greg Myers going to have to make another stop? I don't know. But if he does, well, he's going to be giving up some ground himself. That's now what these drivers are faced with. All I can tell you is that it for sure will catch me out. Now, these guys expect these distances to go, a particular distance. And when it doesn't, and that's the second time I've seen John Watson smack the outside wall of the hairpin. Happen to be on him, and that's just coming out of the pits too, and that's always fun. having all that damage, coming in, finally getting it fixed, going, oh, thank God. Well, now I can get after business and smack on a wall. First thing out of the pits, oh my God. It's like the worst, man. But as we watch it, that is still a fight between those two, Gregory Myers and John Wathan, and that is for the ninth place, regardless of the laps or the time or anything else. We know that we know what the positions are, and that is ninth and tenth. Oh, Wathan! I gotta tell you, fight of the race award, clearly John Wathan, without question. The stick-to-itiveness, the gumption, whatever you want to call it, the gumption award of season 29, I'm calling it right here, John Wathan has earned it completely. The guy just will not give up. looking Monaco in the face and going, no, I'm sticking. Another guy sticking right now, Chris Moses, on teammate Matt Taylor. Now, you know these guys are going to be careful. Chris Moses has the lead in the driver's points. But do you take chances around here? I don't know. You know, maybe not. I think a bit of a wrench has been thrown into the gears of this race now, having to run these extra laps. And so maybe you just kind of say, well, and pit stop strategy too, but at this point, if you're PMR, and this is what they did last season, they just finished both the cars in good points paying positions race after race. That's pretty much the long and short of it. While their competitors would occasionally have, one half of their team have problems, PMR didn't. This is what they did, and it looks like they're doing it again. And I suspect, Chris Moses lead or not, that is going to be the first order of business for these guys. Let's not forget also that these guys will accrue some weight based on their finishing positions. And there is one heck of a fight going on back here over what is right now the 12th position. Curtis Chandler, Omar Gomez, not too far up the road. Jonathan Cuppett. So let's take a look at this as well. So, PMR, shades of last season here, early in season 29, going after... three consecutive championships, so that would be an impressive feat indeed, should they be able to accomplish it. It's going to be a rough season in that regard. Frankly, yes, the 72D is forgiving, but it's not, like, forgiving. You know what I mean? Oh, Marty Uren now having a look and not get it done there. Very tough look there for Marty Uren at that spot. And, okay, we have a late pit stop. I think that was Marty Uren now. No, that was Jonathan Cuppett. Jonathan Cuppett surrendering his position. So, Jonathan Cuppett back now to the 15th position. And this fight still well and truly on. Marty Uren, Curtis Chandler, Omar Gomez. Over 12th. These guys are nearly running inside the top 10. And I gotta tell you, if you're Omar Gomez, that is one heck of a run. And Omar Gomez, I think it should also be said, putting an end quite a few laps here in preparation for this event. I keep looking at the second place Matt Taylor, Chris Moses battle. It is Matt Taylor still out there. So no change there as they run. Ooh, who's that blue getting out of the way? That's some lap traffic. And Marty, you're in. Having that look, but not close enough this time by. And now the laps really are winding down here. So four to go. Do these guys have enough fuel on board? What's the tire situation like? I have no idea. All I know is that it's four laps left to go for these guys. Actually, they're a couple laps off the pace. So, four laps for the leader. but positions up for grabs. As that pass is now being made by Marty Uren. Oh, and Curtis Chandler is going to pull a Massa. Oh, and Marty Uren's going to pull a whoever that was that one time that did that. So, Curtis Chandler smacking the wall on entry. Marty Uren smacking it on exit, but his position to Marty Uren as the lap traffic of Lou Mascarelli just said, okay, well, I'll just go on by here. Because my car is still in good shape. Wow. As the fifth place car, Oscar Lithgow, now comes, and that is a position pickup for Oscar Lithgow. It was John Houston, I believe, in that fifth position at one point in time. John Houston now slipped back to eighth. As the shakeup continues here with these extra laps, I mean, if laps were added, I wasn't notified. Put it that way. So as Oscar Lithgow running a great race in the fifth position now gets lapped by Luis Nieto. So lap now up to the fourth position, and boy, who doesn't like to hear that? Yeah, I lapped up to the fourth position. Suckers, take that. But nonetheless, very fine run here for Oscar Lithgow. And I'm watching that gap there, or have looked at it from time to time, Aaron Parsons to Chris Moses. So Aaron Parsons still running fourth, but giving up time now all the time since he made that pit stop to Chris Moses, is Aaron Parsons. And I certainly suspected he would have some pace on Chris Moses. That turned out not to be true. And the action has settled down here just a little bit now, just a couple laps left to go. Showing that a PMR battle, second and third on track as they run the closest on track at the moment. So some of these drivers back there in the final points paid position running three, even four laps off of the pace. But there are positions which will count in their overall driver classification points, so You got to soldier on. And I suppose that's exactly the point I was making with John Mormon. Regardless of anything, soldier on, because you never know. You could earn an 11th place finish out of it. Wow. What a race. And I suppose if there was any that went into extra innings, this race is as good as any. I mean, why not? Ooh, there's a cut. There's a cut by the Cuppetster. So, you know what? I think I saw him take a cut earlier. However, you know, if it was an unintentional addition of laps, it probably, you might have to throw in an extra cut or two for those guys. Just all kinds of problems on entry, and that's really the trouble with these cars, is getting the braking right. First of all, just because the brakes aren't, you know, great, they're okay, pretty decent, but being able to get the front end to turn in wilts at the same time, not getting the rear to come around on you, which it wants to all the time under those offloading situations. Yeah. Tricky work. And it looks like Jonathan Cuppet not too far off of Marty Uren for that 13th spot. In fact, they are, yeah, nose to gearbox out there on track. So Marty has it all in front of him, all to see it. As soon as that lap counter flips over to 45, we'll make sure we watch the leader in all his glory. But for now, of course, who knows, with the way these positions have flipped around, Marty Uren might be seventh in the next lap and a half here. But looking for just that to hold on to that one position, but it's not, it's maybe going to happen. Holding steady for now, steady as she goes, is Jonathan Cuppet. So, there it is. The final lap now of what will be 45 for Luis Nieto in this extended affair at Monaco. We ended up with a bit of attrition, so five drivers out of the 23 that started. 22, I guess, actually. Samuel did make it 22, jumping in late. And I have to say, a rather light turnout tonight. I would think that this would be a big crowd attraction, but for whatever reason, a little lighter tonight. Of course, we mentioned Ronnie Suarez showing us such great pace last week there at Interlagos, not here tonight, one of the no-shows. And hopefully he will make it back next week, because that team certainly can, looks like they can do some damage. And let's not forget, it's Luis Nieto who's going to collect the glory here tonight for the win, but this team will not do as well as they could with teammate Ronnie Nunez going out early and sacrificing those points here tonight for Monty Python's Racing. And to the line, Luis Nieto, our second round, season 29 winner there in the Lotus 72D. Congratulations to Luis Nieto. Now, he is going to expect me probably to bring him up. I'm not going to tonight, Luis. I'm very sorry. Congratulations on the win. Well deserved, but as our primary broadcaster is not here, don't want to make things too complicated. And we are running a little long as it is, but all the guys will watch the broadcast and I'm sure give you all the due accolades, well-deserved accolades. So, PMR's Matt Taylor, second. PMR's Chris Moses, third. Aaron Parsons showing up. Aaron Parsons will flash through in fourth, and that's the lead lap cars right there. Those are your four lead lap cars. Aaron Parsons, 48 seconds off the pace, and it looked to me like he did have to make that extra pit stop. Don't know what happened there, but Oscar Lithgow, Kevin Miller, John Houston, Ian Jolicoeur, Greg Myers, John Lawton, all in your top 10, and all with great drives tonight at a very tough event, all the way through, very tough track, with that time added. I have to say, just a great job from all those guys. So that's about going to do it. My voice is completely knackered. I'm not going to try to struggle on too much longer. I do want to say and remind you real quickly, for those of you who do watch the rebroadcast, not affiliated with NAGP, but just kind of like watching the races, make sure that you amble on over to the website when you get a chance and check out the action for sure on Thursday nights. In that very exciting Season 29 GT Championship over there. Those guys will be at Suzuka this week, so more of an endurance event style race over there, but a great time over there with Marty Wren and, of course, John Wathen doing the commentating over there and doing a fine job, it has to be said as well. So some good action over there, and of course, we will be right back here next week, same bat channel, same bat time. They're your 9 p.m. Eastern start for the third round of this championship, and it should be a doozy. So until then, thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you next time. I have to figure out which one is which to kill this stuff. Okay.